experimental results and then the discussion about and the conclusion. So introduction, why we need to choose for the lithium ion battery and what is the necessary to use. So since due to the conversion and conventional fuels like coal, oil and natural gases, there is depletion of these of energy resources, right? So we need to go for the alternative energy and alternative ways to reduce the greenhouse gas effects and also the world oil crisis. So what are the other alternative sources we can depend and we need to choose for the alternative sources like that? The first one is the conventional and then the regenerative sources like solar energy and wave energy from the wave which is produced from the seashore area. And another one is particularly electrochemical energy and geothermal energy and wind energy. So about these solar energy, wave energy and geothermal wind energy, these are all need some so highly sophisticated instruments and this is not easy, it's not viable easy. So for the cost effective and then the easy portable, so we need to depend on the electrochemical energy. So in this electrochemical energy, what are the most important factor to use this type of electrochemical energy? We can see. So this is the comparison. In electrochemical energy, there are variety of batteries are available, electrochemical sources are available. So in this case, I would like to give some introduction about the various lithium ion batteries are there. And then conventionally we are using lead acid battery and nickel battery. And just a minute, there are some. Okay, there are some nickel ion battery, lithium polymer battery and the lithium ion batteries are there. So there are some demerits and merits and demerits are there. The first one is the voltage operation, operating voltage, and then the energy density and the cycle life and lifetime for the high duration. These are all the most important factor we need to consider about what type of application you want to use. So the first one is the energy density. Based upon the energy density, we need more energy density and more highly more. So if you want to use for your mobile phone or any gadgets for mobile phone, laptop, iPad, you need the charge should be for longer time, right? So if you want to use for longer time means the energy density also should be more. So compared to other, the lithium ion batteries as a high energy density, the energy density for the lithium ion battery is about roughly 167 watt hour per kilogram. When you consider about the cycle life, the lithium ion batteries use the highest cycle life compared to other like lithium polymer battery and lithium ion battery and lead acid battery and nickel ion battery. So also when you talk about the lifetime also, it gives the higher lifetime compared to others. And especially for the charge time and the safety also, we need to consider more. So in this case, when you consider about the safety, there are some safety concerns in the lithium ion battery. So sometimes you heard about that some Samsung phone and iPhone, sometimes during the charge, during the charging and during the calling time, there is some chances to burst or burn, right? So these are all the main factors we need to consider when you design and develop the next generation lithium ion battery. So you need to carefully choose the materials and anode and cathode and other safety concerns you need to consider when you develop these kind of batteries. So these are the main development and the major applications we are using nowadays. So in this case, we are using for mobile phone gadgets, camera, video camera, and then laptop. And nowadays, we are looking forward for the electric vehicles, right? Electric motorbike and electric car. So nowadays, Elon Musk and Tesla, they are very focusing on the for all type of mobile transportation. They are looking for the alternative energy by using lithium-ion battery. So in this case, for the Tesla, they are using only the lithium-ion battery, which is they are using for the LMNO and then some type of lithium-ion battery anode and cathode materials. I can discuss with you later. So before I go to detailed introduction and then the detailed scientific technical term, I would like to introduce about the major components of the lithium-ion battery. So here we can divide it in three type of classification. One is the cathode and the electrolyte and anode. These are the main parts in the lithium-ion battery. So when you talk about the cathode, it is again we can be classified as a two type of cathode materials. One is the insertion material and then the conversion material. And based upon the electrolytes, again we can kind of classify to the three types of materials. One is the electrolyte, polymer material, and solid state material. And again, anode, it can also be classified to the three type of material. One is the insertion material and the alloy DLI material, and again the conversion material. So here I would like to talk about the cathode material and anode material. So in this case, here there are variety of method, cathode and anode materials are there. So I would like to talk about the lithium manganese oxide cathode material. And again here, the insertion material like lithium titanium anode. So lithium titanate. So I would like to give some more introduction about this. So how in this case, how you can concern about and how what are the main factors you need to consider to develop the lithium ion battery with high efficiency, highly safety, and then the more energy density. So when you talk about the lithium ion battery, I would like to give some short introduction and mechanism about the lithium ion battery. So here, this is the, you can see the movement of electron and lithium ion. So here what is happen from the anode, there will be formation of the lithium ion, and the cathode, there will be produce of electron. So when you charge, the lithium ion can move towards to the cathode material, and then from the cathode, the electron can easily move towards the anode material. So in between there is some electrolyte and separator. So when produce the electron, these electron can easily move towards the current collector, and your mobile phone will be charged. So in this case, this is the anode and cathode reaction equation. You can see here. In the anode reaction, there will be produce of electron, and the cathode reaction, there will be producement of the lithium ions. So the net reaction is here. So finally, if you use the lithium anode as a carbon material, and then the lithium cobalt as a cathode material, this is the final net reaction. This is the highly reversible material. This is the main condition, is it should be highly equilibrium, and it should be easily convertible to each other. So in this case, I would like to talk about the various surface modification of the anode and cathode materials, and how we can expect more highly efficient and highly safety lithium ion batteries. So when you talk about the development and the next generation of cathode materials and the anode materials, there is a formation of the solid electrolyte interface film. So this is the highly crucial point and a highly crucial feature about the when you talk about the low cost effect, there will be possibility to use the carbon material as anode material. So when you charge and discharge the battery, there is a formation of the permanent formation of lithium carbonate and lithium carbon compounds. So this is highly irreversible material. So when you charge the lithium ion battery, there is a formation of at around 0.7 volt, there is a formation of lithium carbon, lithium carbide material. So it is highly irreversible material, and there will be formation of SEI film. So this is the film it causes to the bursting or burning of the battery and mobile phone. So we need to avoid this kind of SEI film. So if you suppress the formation of this kind of SEA film, you can expect the more lifetime and then the more charging and discharging ability. And then when you talk about the anode materials, the mostly they are using lithium titanate anode material. This is highly efficient material and low cost also. So this is the titanium is most abundant material, and lithium also the most abundant earth abundant material. So when you combine these two, you can get the low cost and highly efficient, and the high more density also you can expect. So when you talk about the major features about the lithium titanate, this is the zero strain during the charge and discharge process, and it can give the excellent cycle performance, and the cycle life also you can expect more. Also, when you talk about the lithium ion reversibility, it has the high reversibility and high coulomb efficiency. And also, it has the highest operating voltage potential at about 1.55 volt. When you compare to the carbon material, it has the highest operating potential. So, when you talk about the further development of these type of anode and cathode materials, there are so many modification methods are available. One is the diamond reduction. Dimension reduction means you can reduce the particle size. And the whole diamond.
Doctor, your voice is breaking.
I think. Yeah, can you able to hear now?
Okay.
So when you talk about the surface modification of these either anode and or cathode materials, there is a possibility to reduce the particle size, and then the composite formation, and doping and functionalization of the anode and cathode materials, and then the morphology control. And the coating and encapsulation over the surface of cathode and anode materials, and finally the modification of electrolyte materials. So here I would like to talk about two type of development in the anode and cathode materials. One is the coating material, and then the electrolyte modification. So when you talk about the coating and the encapsulation, we would like to give some carbon coating over the lithium titanate, and then we would like to modify some electrolyte modification during and adding some additive as a chemical agents. The first one is we would like to give some carbon coating either by one step method and two step method, and the second method is we would like to add some chemical additives to enhance the formation of SEI film and to give the highest performance and the highest ability. So the first step and the formation, the modification of anode material is we would like to coat the two type of coating, carbon coating material over the lithium titanate by using sucrose as a carbon source. By using one step method and two step method, in the one step method it is just simple adding the sucrose with the precursor agent. The precursor agent is lithium acetate dehydrate, and then the tetrabutyl titanate as a titanium source, and citric acid as a capping agent. So when you combine these in the sol-gel method, you can prepare the lithium titanate by using this simple step. In the case of the two-step method, after you prepare the lithium titanate by using the high energy ball milling method, just add some more amount of sucrose as a carbon source material, just 3 weight percent. Here we are using just only one 3 weight percent as a carbon source material. So this is the conventional characterization of X-ray diffraction analysis to confirm the carbon coating and then the formation of lithium titanate. So in this case, we have confirmed that the formation of lithium titanate anode material with the highest crystalline and then the carbon coating layer over the material. And this is the scanning electron microscopy to confirm the particle size, particle morphology, and the chemical composition over the surface material. So here we would like to confirm the particle size is around 0.95 micrometer of lithium titanate. And then the carbon material by single step and one step is about 0.74 micrometer, and then the 0.87 micrometer of two step method. So in this case, by using the EDAX analysis, the carbon content also we have confirmed that by using the single step method, the 1.16 weight percentage, and then by using the two step method, we have confirmed the 1.81 percentage. So this is roughly confirmed that the presence of the carbon material over the surface of anode materials. And this is the high resolution TEM studies to confirm the crystalline behavior and then the coating layer, and then how much thickness of the coating layer also is the matter one. So whether it is present or not, we have confirmed by using the TEM analysis. So in this case, the carbon nano layer was obviously fine. It was the highly uniformly coated over the surface of lithium titanate. And in the case of the, you can see here by using the single step method, the carbon layer is evenly formed throughout the surface of the lithium titanate, LTO material. But in the case of the two step method, there is some discontinuous and then it is not uniform one. So this uniform layer and the coating thickness is a highly important one to give the highest performance and other things. So this is the schematic diagram of the preparation of LTO by using the carbon coating. So this is the step, by using the one step method during the synthesis of the LTO, we have just added the carbon source, the sucrose we have added, and it gives the even and the uniform layer over the LTO material. But in the case of the two-step method, once preparation of the LTO without the carbon source, and the second step by ball milling, we have added the sucrose. So it gives the discontinuous and the ununiform layer. So how these prepared material, it is affected towards the efficiency and other things during the lithium ion battery's performance. So this is again the Raman analysis to confirm the presence of the carbon coating. So by using the Raman is the main tool to confirm the crystalline behavior of the carbon material. So whether there is a D-band and G-band, we have to confirm by using the Raman analysis. So we have confirmed that the D-band and G-band is available and presence over the coating material. And this is the conventional CV to confirm about the charge and discharge behavior by using the cyclic voltammetric analysis. So in this case, you can see that when you increase the scan rate from the 0.1 millivolt per second to 2 millivolt second, it gives the highest current density. That means there is the equal redox potential. The anode and cathode, it becomes the well. And also, when you talk about the charge and discharging material, the diffusion coefficient is the main key component we need to confirm by using the CV analysis. So in this case, we have confirmed that by using the single step method, the diffusion coefficient, it gives the highest value, like 2.19 into 10 to the power minus 8 Siemens square. So this is a crucial point we need to consider about the diffusion coefficient behavior. And then this is the charge and discharge performance of the lithium titanate LTO with the carbon coating electrolyte. So in this case, you can see here this is the single step method and then a two step method. The flat operation potential plateau at around 1.56 volt is mainly attributed to the two phase insertion reaction between lithium 4 Ti5 O2 and lithium 7 Ti5 and O12. So this is the key component when we talk about the charge and discharging materials. Also, it gives the highest capacity, discharge capacity around 172.5 milliampere per hour. And again, we need to confirm the capacity retention by using the cycling performances. Again, in the single step method, it gives the highest rate performance throughout the studies by using different scan rates and different C rate analysis. And this is the electrochemical impedance analysis. This is the crucial study we need to carry out to analyze the conducting behavior and then the whole performance of the lithium ion battery or any type of electrochemical studies. Without electrochemical impedance, we cannot say anything. So in this case, we have to confirm that the charge transfer rate and then the resistance of the material. So here we have confirmed that the charge transfer analysis by using the electrochemical impedance analysis. We have observed very low amount of charge transfer resistance, that is only 76.9 ohm. So this is the highly crucial point when we need to consider about the charge and discharging studies and then the resistance of the battery. So I would like to conclude that by using the carbon coating by different type of methods, one is the single step and two step method, it gives the single step method, it gives the highest performance by using the carbon coating material. These single step method, it gives the even and homogeneous coating over the surface. So this is the highly crucial point we need to consider and about the safety and performance of the lithium ion battery. So this data has been published in the Journal of Solid State Electrochemistry last year. And another study I would like to introduce, and short introduction I need to give because this material is not published yet. So I just give some very little information about this. So when we talk about the electrolyte modification or the electrolyte surface modification, we have added the butadiene sulfone and the formation of SEA layer on lithium titanate anode material. So this is the simple schematic diagram of the whole study. We have used the butadiene sulfone as a electrolyte additive to enhance the solid electrolyte interface film. So once this butadiene sulfone reduced during the charge and discharge of the initial studies, so it can enhance and it can prevent the further formation of SEA layer. So the electron transfer between the anode and cathode will be faster, and then it can enhance this type of SEA layer. It has the highly porous material, so the movement of electron and then the lithium ion can be very fast and then very easy. So this idea has been behind this. So in this case, we have analyzed by using the SEM and the TGA analysis and XPS. And to confirm the electrochemical studies, we have used electrochemical impedance spectroscopy and then the galvanostatic charge and discharge and CV as conventional. So this is the crucial study to confirm the formation of SEA layer. So when you carry out the cyclic voltammetric studies, the formation of SEA layer was confirmed around 1.12 volt. So this is the crucial point to confirm the formation of SEA layer. And then again, after that, there is no formation of SEA layer, right? So during the first cycle and second cycle and third cycle, we need to confirm either the further formation of SEA layer or not. And in this case, we have studied by using different amount of butadiene sulfone as an additive material from 0.5 weight percentage to 4 weight percentage. So in this case, the 0.5 and 0.1, it gives the highest performance of all electrochemical performance, because when you add the more amount of the electrolyte, it is the thickness of the SEA layer will be more. So the movement of electron and the movement of lithium ion will be suppressed. So in this case, we have confirmed that the 0.58% of butadiene sulfone is the best one to enhance the electrochemical performance. Also, we would like to emphasize that when we use this type of butadiene sulfone, it the formation of sulfonyl group, it the sulfonyl group has the highest electronegativity, so it can enhance, and the reduction behavior also will be enhanced. The overall electrochemical performance we can be expected more. And then this is the scanning electrochemical microscopy to confirm the formation of SEA layer over the surface of the lithium titanate material. So in this case, we have confirmed that the SEA film covers the electrode surface completely with some cracks. So when you add more amount of the butadiene sulfone, the cracks and porous film will be more. So the optimal percentage is 0.58% of butadiene sulfone is the best one. And we have optimized this concentration for the further electrochemical performance. And then to quantitatively analyze about the SEA layer over the LTO surface, we have confirmed, we have analyzed the TGA analysis to quantitatively confirm the amount present over the SEA layer. So from the from this study, we have confirmed that the high amount of SEA layer was formed over the surface anode materials. It comes from the 4.8% of butadiene sulfone. And then the less amount we have confirmed by using the 0.5 butadiene sulfone, 8%. And again, we have confirmed the formation of SEA layer by using ATR-IR and then the XPS analysis. So by using these type of analysis, we have confirmed that the various functional groups of butadiene sulfone and then the SEA layer we have confirmed. So this is the XPS analysis to confirm the various compounds and various chemical compounds formed during the charge and discharge analysis and then the SEA layer over the LTO surfaces. So here we need to consider about the various compounds like inorganic and organic material. So when you talk about the inorganic materials, the formation of lithium carbonate is the major component. And then some compounds of the organometallic like ethyl acetate or ethyl compound is a major one. And here the formation of lithium carbonate is the crucial. And then the formation of lithium sulfate also is the crucial point. So when we talk about the presence and the quantification of amount of the lithium carbonate and then the lithium sulfate is the matter one. So we have confirmed that the lithium sulfate is the major components here. So since this lithium sulfate is the key factor to transport of electron and lithium ion in the electrolyte film. So when we talk about the electrolyte film, it will be formed in the behind the separator and before the cathode material and the current collector. So this is the crucial point I would like to emphasize about the electrochemical performance. So with this, I can conclude that when we add small amount of the electrochemical additive agents in the electrolyte, also the electrochemical performance and the overall energy density, we can be we can enhance by using these type of chemical agents. And another, I would like to give short introduction about the cathode materials which we are using for the lithium ion batteries. So when we talk about the cathode materials, the spinel lithium manganese oxide also we can be used. So here we have tried and prepared and developed this kind of cathode materials in our laboratory, and this results has been published in the Ceramic International last month. So I would like to give some short introduction about the preparation of LnMO by using Sol-Gel synthesis, just mixing up the various precursors for the nickel, manganese and lithium. Just mix it for the mixing state for some time, and then add ethylene glycol and then the water for mixing, and the oil bath in the oil bath the temperature of 120 to 150 degrees centigrade for just 5 to 6 hours. And then after the Sol-Gel preparation, after the evaporation of the solvent, this material can be transferred to the furnace for the calcination. So initially we have the calcination methods we have to do in two different steps. The first calcination is 450 degrees centigrade, and then the second calcination we need to optimize. This is the crucial point to consider about the synthesis of the LnMO or any anode and cathode materials. The calcination temperature is the major factor and it gives the major influence. So if you want to modify the surface morphology or the crystallinity behavior and then the whole ultimate material, this is a crucial point. So in this method we have optimized by using the various calcination temperature. So when you change the calcination temperature, what are the other effects we can expect, and what are the other thing we can be concentrate to develop this kind of cathode material we have tried. So in this case we have tried from 600 degrees centigrade to 1000 degrees centigrade. So what are the other effects we can be seeing the coming slides. And this is the just a minute. This is the fabrication of electrode for the coin cell. So I don't want to give more information about this because I think most of the people are aware of this. So this is the key components of the coin cell. So if you consider most of the people, you might have seen the coin cell for the battery, the coin cell battery for the mobile phone, sorry, not mobile phone, for the watches, and then the clock for a small gadgets like that, right? So you can see here, this is can be classified as a CR2032. So whatever the coin cell type battery you have seen, this it is the type of 2032. So in this case, there are the major components here. This is the bottom, and this is the electrode sheet. So this is for the anode material. We need to coat for the current collector. This is the aluminum foil. For the anode material, it will be the copper current collector we have to use. So this is the bottom material, and then this is the electrode sheet which the LnMO has been coated over the aluminum foil, and then the lithium foil. This is the lithium source for the lithium ion battery, and then this is the o-ring, and this is the stainless sheet to give the support, and this is the spring, and this is the top material. So in this case we have used the fabrication of the cathode material as a LnMO as a cathode material, and we have confirmed that we have studied the dissolution test. So this dissolution test is the key factor to analyze various anode and cathode materials. So we have mimicked the condition about the dissolution of various cathode and anode material. So in this case, we have chosen the lithium phosphofluoride, and then the EC and DEC solution at the 55 degrees centigrade to mimic the high temperature cathode material. So how the various calcination temperature influence in the dissolution of the electrolytes we have studied. And this is the TAFL analysis to confirm the electrochemical, various electrochemical performances. And by using these LNMO material, we have applied the atomic layer deposition also we have tried by using alumina oxide as a coating material. I would like to go through very fast because I would like to give more introduction about my company and then the more interesting information. So I would like to give some very short and very precise information about this type of studies and other thing. So we have confirmed the formation of highly crystalline material of LNMO by using XRD analysis. And then this is the Raman analysis to confirm the various key components and then the key metal oxides by using the Raman analysis. So we have confirmed that the 400 centimeter inverse and then 490 and the 636 centimeter inverse, we have confirmed the formation of nickel oxide and then the manganese oxide. So in these LNMO, we need to consider about the phases of the LNMO phase. So the first one is the FD3M phase and then the P4332 phase. These are the key components which gives the highest electrochemical performance. So the percentage of these phases, it gives the it matters the electrochemical performance in the following studies. So this is the scanning electrochemical microscopy, electron microscope to confirm the morphology of the LNMO. So when you increase the sintering calcination temperature, the surface morphology is the best one. And then it gives the exhibit also when you increase the higher temperature, it exhibits the clean, smooth, and the spinal structure we have obtained, and the particle size also become nearly more nearly. That means the even and the homogeneous particle surface we have obtained. And this is the particle size distribution of LNMO by using the zeta sizer. So in this case, when you increase the calcination temperature, the particle sizes also increases. That means the particle growth will be more when you increase the calcination temperature. So this is the average particle size when you increase the temperature, calcination temperature. From when you apply the 600 degree centigrade, the particles, the average particle size would be the 0.68 micrometer. And in the case of the 1000 degree centigrade, the particle size is about when you convert from the micrometer to nanometer, this is the 900 nanometer. And when you apply the 900 degree centigrade, you can expect the 500 and something nanometer. So this is very clear about that when you increase the temperature, the particle morphology and then the particle size also increases. So these are the key steps and key points we need to consider about the electrochemical performances. And this is the cyclic voltammetry gram. So here you can clearly see that the formation and the electrochemical reduction of the LNMO from When you talk about the 600 degree centigrade, the implement of the formation of Mn3 plus is very less compared to the 900 degree centigrade and 1000 degree centigrade. Also, the electrochemical potential from 4.72 volt to 4.62 volt, this is a crucial volt. And then when we talk about the redox couple of the these calcination temperature also is the matter one. And this is the electrochemical characterization for the LNMO cathode material. So you can expect that the highest electrochemical performance for the 900 degree centigrade compared to the others. And this is the electrochemical characterization by using the cycling performance analysis. And this study also, it gives the highest coulombic efficiency for the 900 degree centigrade and then the 1000 degree centigrade. That means when you increase the calcination temperature, the particle size can be increased, but the crystallinity and then the surface morphology and then the movement of electron and the movement of the lithium ion is the highly important one. So when increase the calcination temperature, the crystallinity is increases and also the electrochemical performance also increases. And the main thing is we need to consider about the capacity retention. For the 600 degree centigrade, the capacity retention is 90%. And when we talk about the highest calcination temperature for the 900 degree centigrade and then the 1000 degree centigrade, it gives almost the 97% and 98%. This is the key factor when we increase the calcination temperature. So as I said earlier, the electrochemical impedance spectroscopy is the key tool to analyze the electrochemical performance of the any either cathode material or anode material. So here also the less charge transfer resistance we have obtained for the 900 degree centigrade and then the 1000 degree centigrade. So you can see here the charge transfer resistance for the 900 degree centigrade merely 57.92. But in the case of the 600 degree centigrade and then the 800 degree centigrade and 700 degree centigrade, it is 5 times more compared to the 900 degree centigrade and then the 1000 degree centigrade. And also we have analyze the corrosion studies, because these corrosion property is a major and key points when we talk about the safety concern and then the of the lithium ion battery. So the corrosion is nothing but when we during the charge and discharging, the formation of SCI layer and then the formation of lithium components is the key factor, and it called as a corrosion in the lithium ion battery. So we have studied about the corrosion studies by using the TAFL analysis. So in this TAFL analysis also, we have confirmed that the low current density for the 900 degree centigrade and then the 1000 degree centigrade. And then this is the corrosion potential about the 900 degree centigrade and the 1000 degree centigrade. So it gives the highest corrosion potential and then the lowest corrosion current, lowest current. So it means that the formation of the SCA layer over the cathode material is very thin, and then the transportation of electron is very fast. And this is the dissolution test. This dissolution test, it means that the dissolution of various metal ions, how much fast it is dissolute in the particular electrolyte solution. So we have studied by using that EC and DEC as a solvent and then the lithium phosphate as a electrolyte material. So in this case, the lower amount of nickel and manganese is dissolution. That means when we increase the calcination temperature, the dissolution of metal from the cathode material is very less compared to the others. I think this is the conclusion about the present study. When we talk about the calcination, which one is the best calcination temperature for the to develop the cathode material, is the 900 degree centigrade is the best one, and we have optimized this type of LNMO material. And this data has been published in the Ceramic International just 10 days before. So I think I can conclude this session with the with this presentation. I can move to the another part and another useful information for you all. Until now, I have presented my research experience during the postdoctoral studies at Tatung University. So hereafter, I would like to introduce some useful information and the most practical application for the current periods and then this coronavirus pandemic situation. So I would like to introduce about my present company, and we are I'm working in the Tripod Nanotechnology Corporation as a senior specialist. So already Dr. Murugadas introduced about me. So directly I would like to go to the introduction about my company and then what we are doing especially. So our company, we are manufacturing and producing the various metal and metal oxide nanoparticle, which is highly efficient, and by just a simple method, the metal dissolution by using green technology. So by using green technology means we have developed one technology which is patented in 6 different countries, and also we have obtained more than 15 patents about the green technology process. So when you synthesize the green metal nanoparticles, you need to depend on the organic reagents or organic agents. But here in our methods, we are using only water as a solvent and some chemical agents to stabilize and capping agents. So we are working and developing the colloidal metal nanoparticle, colloidal metal and metal oxide nanoparticle for 8 different applications. And we are working as a key factor and then the key role, the business to business model, and we can call it as a original innovation manufacturer. So originally we are innovating more products and technology to enhance the day-to-day applications. So this is our core products we are manufacturing currently. So this is the colloidal metal nanoparticle, and this is the colloidal metal oxide nanoparticle, and this is colloidal nanoparticle composites, and also we are developing some metal salts and customized the products by using the selenium nanoparticle. So these in this presentation I would like to give some introduction and some precise information about the rapid test kit analysis. So when we talk about the rapid test kit analysis, the heart of the rapid test kits is the nanoparticles, nano compounds we need to use as a labeling material to combine the antigen and antibody. I hope you all aware of about the antigen and antibody and then the bioconjugation and other things. So we are developing the gold nanoparticle and various metal and metal oxide nanoparticle to use in the rapid test kit analysis. So when we talk about the rapid test kit analysis, that is lateral flow immunoanalysis. So here I think you all heard about the rapid test kit. Rapid test kit, we are, the government is always says that we are importing and the rapid test kit analysis from various countries like China and Korea. So we are the key player to give the rapid test kit analysis using the gold nanoparticle, platinum and gold with the zirconium and selenium nanoparticle. So maybe I can give you the introduction about the rapid test kit kits. So these are the some advantages about our nanoparticle. So it can give the enhanced solubility in dispersed water, and then the low limit of detection, and then the less time consumption, and then it is the water based solvent and easy in conjugation with the biomolecules, and then variety of test line colors. So this is the key factor, the test line color. It should give the high most intense color when we use about the various nanoparticle. So when you talk about the rapid test kits, so it is nothing but we heard about the to confirm the pregnancy, they are using some kits, right? That is the rapid test kit. To confirm the coronavirus also, you can be used this type of rapid test kits. So not only for the coronavirus and then the pregnancy, we can able to detect the infection disease from the animals and humans, and also for the food products also we can be used. How you can use for the food products means, if there is any adulterated in the food, and then the if for example in the milk, what we are drinking in the morning for coffee and tea, to produce some more amount of milk, they will give some hormones to the cows. So when they give the hormone to the cows, the cow can give more amount of milk. So this hormone can carry forward in the milk. So when we drink the same hormone, we will also obtain. So we need to make sure that there is no amount of, there is the presence, no presence of the absence of the hormones. So we can rely on this very rapid test kit to easy analyze and the very fast analysis. And also we can, the same method we can apply for the drug analysis also. So maybe I can give you the short introduction about the what is the lateral flow immunoassay. That this is the definition of the lateral flow analysis. It is a simple to use diagnostic device used to confirm the presence or absence of the target analyte, such as the pathogens or biomarkers in humans or animals, or contaminants in water supplies, foodstuffs or animal stuffs. So not only for the food products, we can able to analyze the heavy metal ions present in the water also. Either it may be the heavy metal ions, or it may be any bacteria or viruses, if contaminated in the water also, we can be able to analyze by using this type of test kits. So this is the major test kits for the to confirm the pregnancy or ovulation time also, we can be able to identify. So why we need to choose this type of lateral flow immunoassay means, these are inexpensive methods, and then at some point of time you can be analyzed the qualitative and quantitative results also analyzed. But the major components of this is the nanoparticle. The expansiveness is determined by the what kind of nanomaterial and what kind of antigen antibody you are using. This is the key points we need to consider. And as I said earlier, not only what are the various application we can be used by using the rapid test kit analysis. As I said earlier, the feed testing, environmental analysis we can be done, and then the food adulteration we can be identified, and the plant and crop health also we can be analyzed, and then in the pharma and the animal health also we can be analyzed. So I think give the more information about this. So due to the time constraint, I would like to give some major information only. So this is the main components of the rapid test kit, that is a lateral flow immunoassay. So in this case, there will be the sample application pad and the conjugation pad and nitrocellulose membrane and then the absorbent pad. So here you will be drop your blood or drop the urine to confirm the pregnancy. So this is the sample pad, and this is the most important region. This is the conjugation pad. Here you will be use the any nanoparticle, especially in general 99% of the rapid test kits lateral flow immunoassay, they are using the golden nanoparticle as the major component as a labeling material. So this is the point, this is the material we are developing nowadays in our company. So this is the various formats and various types of the lateral flow immunoassay. So in this case, majorly there are two type of LFA test kits are available. One is the sandwich method and then the competitive method. So the sandwich method is the convenient one and very fast and easy process. And when we talk about the labeling material, there are variety of labeling materials are available, but how we can choose the labeling material for the lateral flow analysis is the key point. So here there are some important points we need to consider about the labeling material is that it should be enhance the sensitivity, and then it should be easy for the scaling process, and then the clear definition between the test line and control line. So when we talk about the lateral flow analysis, there will be two line. One is the test line and control line. So it should be highly distinguishable and easily identified by the naked eye. So when we talk about the labeling material, there are variety of labeling materials available, but there are merits and demerits are there. So in most of the studies, the golden nanoparticle can be used as a labeling material for the highest efficiency and low detection method, and then the for long time duration of storage, and then the long time stability. So these are all introduction about the labeling material. So I can go for here. So this is the major and main important points I need to tell you about the rapid test kits, about the material cost and structure of the rapid test kits. So when we talk about the rapid test kit and its cost, these are the major components. It shares the percentage of the cost. The nanocellulose membrane, it gives the contribution of 10%, and the antigen antibody, which is a highly expensive one, and it shares the 55% of the rapid test kit. And most importantly, the colloidal nanoparticle for the labeling material, it shares the 35% of the rapid test kit and its expense and its cost. So our tripod nanotechnology, we are developing and we are focusing how we can give the low cost material and high efficiency and low detection amount. So in this case, it should be water insoluble. At the same time, it should be easily interact with the water, because when we analyze for the coronavirus or any type of infection, our whole body is made up of water, right? So it should be easily interact with the water, but it should not insoluble in the water. So in this condition, we have developed 5 different nanoparticle, and it gives the various colors like that. As I said earlier, the 99% of the rapid test kit, they are using golden nanoparticle, and we have developed the platinum and the gold with platinum and selenium and gold with zirconium oxide. So you can see the various color ranges. So when we analyze the rapid test kits, it can give the highly distinguishable test line and control line by using this type of labeling material as a nanoparticle. And these are all some advantages on why we need to choose the different type of nanoparticle and other thing. And especially we are now focusing on the selenium nanoparticle as a labeling material, but it can give the rust color compared to the gold golden nanoparticle. Golden nanoparticle, it can give the right orange red or the pink color, light pink color it can give. But when you choose the selenium nanoparticle, it can give the rust color, which is highly brown, and then the high intense color, and then it can give the highly biocompatible, and then the especially compared to the gold nanoparticle, the selenium nanoparticle, it can give the highest efficiency with the low cost amount. And there are so many materials can be used, but the when we talk about the stability and then high efficiency and the low detection method, we cannot go for the iron oxide or carbon nanoparticle or quantum dots. We cannot be used, but we can be used. It depends on the application, and it depends on the need, and it depends on the what are the antigen and antibody you are going to use. And these are, we have developed, and currently there are many products that are available in the market, in Taiwan market it is available to confirm the renal function of our the kidney, and then the nucleic acid rapid test to identify the strawberry disease, strawberry plant disease, and then for pets also we can be able to easily identify the infection disease like that. And these are the some important players, key players, and then the various products are available in the current market. And this is all about the rapid test flow analysis. So what I would like to give you the information is the usage of the various nanoparticle, and then the practical application in day-to-day life. We can able to make, and we can able to give you the low cost and the high efficiency material. And I would like to conclude this session by saying, be safety and stay in the home, and always wear the mask, and always hand wash when you go out and when you stay outside. Thank you very much for your nice present introduction about me by Dr. Murugadas, and thank you very much for the giving opportunity to express my research experience and share our thought.
Okay, thank you very much doctor. Thank you very much for the excellent talk about development of anode and cathode material construction of the next generation lithium antibody, and also rapid test production from your company. And it is really more informative talk for researcher who are working in the energy storage material and the medicine field. Once again, thank you, doctor, for thank accepting you. My invitation. This is actually end of the time for the 2 days virtual seminar. I strongly believe the participant were gained more information from the 5 excellent speaker on the energy conversion and the storage technology. Once again, I remember to the participant, kindly fill the feedback form and send to us before leave the Zoom link. Now I wish to my sincere thank to the management of Satya Bhouma Institute of Science and Technology for their valuable supporting to successfully conducting their webinar. Moreover, I like to my great thanks to Dr. Sasibirwa Madam, Vice Chancellor, and Dr. Kupaswamy Sir, and Dr. Kamalan, and my dear colleague from Center for Nano Science and Technology for their constant support and conduct this international virtual seminar. I also my great thanks for all the 5 speaker for their excellent talk and the podium. We will distribute the e-certificate to the all participant within a week. Once again, thanks to all. Devin sir, your overall talk is really very excellent. Especially your talk about the cold nanoparticle for the rabbit kits. Dr. Kamalan.
Sir.
Okay. Maybe you can wait up to 5 to 10 minutes for getting the feedback form.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Also, after complete that session, maybe you can send to that YouTube link for share to that.
Already the, shared in this
chat box. Possible send to my WhatsApp also after complete the session.
Okay.
Okay, can I leave?
Okay, sir.